physics. It's all around us. No matter what type of vehicle you ride, no matter what you build, no matter what you play, the laws of physics govern everything that is happening around us. Physics helps us to understand how things work in a teeny tiny world and the cosmos as a whole. We have had brilliant minds like Newton, Tesla, Edison, Michael Faraday in the past and in the present, making great contributions in unlocking the secrets of physics. Inarguably, physics, especially experimental physics, has made and is still making our lives better one day at a time. Physicists are continuously trying to demystify everything around us. Over the course of time, when they try to solve problems, they discover something new and revolutionary. The birth of electronics is one fine example. In fact, electronics was just a branch of physics. I will include some significant breakthroughs that led to the birth of electronics as a new domain, but hey, there is a lot to discuss. Though the concept of electricity vaguely existed for thousands of years, it was only in 1752 when Benjamin Franklin proved that lightning itself was electric in nature. He was the first one to use the terms like positive and negative charges. Tinkerers around the world were conducting several experiments just after the invention of electricity because nobody had any idea about the electrical properties of different things. However, some series of incidents happened in the late 19th century. Let me narrate the story of how Edison stumbled upon something entirely new while trying to solve a problem. Around the 1880s, we already had a crude form of electric light bulbs and cathode ray tubes. It was the same period when Thomas Alva Edison was trying to find the reason for the short lifespan of the filaments in his light bulbs as well as the bulb blackening problem. During one of his experiments, he inserted a metal plate on top of the original filament and connected the plate to the positive terminal of the battery through a galvanometer. Galvanometer is just an electromechanical device to indicate the flow of electric current. When he connected the battery, this galvanometer showed a small deflection indicating current flow through this wire. Then he removed this wire and connected it to the negative terminal of the battery. This plate would have negatively charged since it is connected to the negative terminal of the battery. Guess what happened? The current flow had stopped and this galvanometer didn't show any deflection. Edison was unsure what was going on, but it was a successful experiment and it worked every time. That's science. Edison realized that he had identified a new phenomenon while trying to solve the problems with his light bulbs. He started looking to find a commercial application for this experiment. So he went ahead and got a patent for that experiment by the title Electrical Indicator in 1884. Today, we call this phenomenon the Edison Effect. However, what happened was a process called thermionic emission. Let me tell you what it is. Metals have atoms and we have the nucleus at the center and the electrons in different energy levels. When you heat the metal, this electron will gain energy and jump to the next energy level. At some point of time, they will try to eject themselves from the metal. But it's difficult for them to escape from the surface of the metal because of the attractive force with the nucleus. But if you do the same inside a vacuum, then this electron can quickly gain enough energy to break this attractive force and becomes free electrons and thus moves freely inside the vacuum. Technically, we call the minimum required energy to break this attractive force as work function. Adequately, if you can manipulate the free electrons inside the vacuum, then you can build all sorts of electronic components. So back to the experiment. When Edison connected this plate to the positive terminal of the battery, he made this plate positively charged, which attracted the free electrons traveling in the vacuum from the hot filament. These free electrons that are negatively charged are then traveled through this wire, through the galvanometer and discharged to the positive terminal of the battery. This flow of electrons or current was indicated by this galvanometer as deflection. However, when he connected the plate to the negative terminal of the battery, he made the plate negatively charged that ripples the free electrons inside the vacuum. Because like charges ripple. Today we know like charges ripple and opposite charges attract. But at that time, electron and its charge itself was yet to be discovered. Later, in 1897, Sir J Thomson was working on a cathode ray tube. Cathode ray tube consists of an evacuated tube where you can connect the anode and cathode to a high voltage power supply. The anode had a small hole in it. When you apply a high voltage power supply, The free electrons from the cathode will travel so fast through the vacuum to reach the positively charged anode. Since there is a small hole in the anode, some free electrons will pass through this hole and hit the end of the tube. Now if you apply a fluorescent coating on the tube, it will make the tube to glow very beautifully when the electrons interacted with the coating. However, nobody knows much about why it works, but it was famously used by tinkerers to show off. Thomson wanted to understand the reason for this glow, so he referenced papers published by many great scientists and started working on his cathode ray tube. Again, nobody knew about the electron. All they knew was that the rays itself originated from the cathode, and hence they were calling it cathode rays. So Thomson performed some experiments with his cathode ray tube. He tried to replace the electrode with a different metal, but no matter what type of electrode he used, the results were same. So his first conclusion was that all metals emit cathode rays. Then he put a positive and negatively charged plates on the sides of the path of the rays. And he immediately noticed the rays deflected towards the positive terminal like this. He didn't understand the reason for this deflection, so he tried to reverse the polarity of this electrode. When he reversed the plates, the rays again bent towards the positively charged plates. By this experiment, he concluded that the cathode rays by itself must be negatively charged. Thomson knows that the charged particle could be affected by the magnetic fields. So he tried to put a magnet over the rays, and indeed, the rays reacted the same to the magnetic field. Thus, he realized that these must carry an electric charge. He then went on to measure the charge to mass ratio of these negatively charged rays based on the applied electric field and the deflection of the rays. We are not going to discuss the mathematics behind this number in this video. And as a result of his experiments, he concluded that the cathode rays in fact consist of negatively charged particles called corpuscles. And this particle has less than 2/1000th of the size of a hydrogen atom. At first, many scientists didn't believe him, because at that time, scientists believed that atoms are the smallest and nothing is smaller than the atoms. But Thomson suggested something that is smaller than the smallest of all atoms. However, further experiments confirmed his results. But many scientists didn't like the name corpuscles. They preferred a much older name called electron. The name electron was initially coined by an Irish physicist, Johnstone Stoney, 10 years back to denote the unit of charge while passing the electric current through chemicals in his experiments. However, scientists already knew that the atoms are electrically neutral. So if the building block of atoms, as suggested by Thomson, was negatively charged, then there must be an equal amount of positive charge to make them neutral, right? So Thomson went on to propose his plum pudding model. This is it. In his plum pudding model, Thomson proposed that just like these berries, the negatively charged electrons are spread in a sphere of positive charge. This is not a sphere, but you get it right. But this model was later proved wrong by Rutherford and Niels Bohr. And now we have a well-defined atomic theory that says the nucleus is at the center and the electrons revolve around them in different energy levels. So now we know something about the electron, its behavior, its charge to mass ratio. However, we don't know the actual charge or mass of the electron. Later in 1913, physicist Robert A. Millikan and his friend Harvey Fletcher measured the closest to the actual electric charge of the electron with his famous oil drop experiment. They substituted the charge of the electron in Thomson's charge to mass ratio and found out the mass of the electron as well. Fine. That's it for this week. In my upcoming videos, we will discuss some essential functions of an electronic device and its history as well. We will continue in part 2. Thanks for watching this video. Bye.